The talk will be given by Philippe and Yves Crass. So,
good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, everybody. First, I am very proud and very happy to speak in front of you this morning about Jürgen Flute Player. Second, I have to inform you that I split my presentation in two parts because the first part is only history throughout the ages and the second part is more a drama. It's more a thriller between Roulet, Jean Roulet, a French manufacturer, and Alexandre Nicolas Théroud, another French manufacturer, from whom we don't know if the first or the other make the flute player automaton we speak about. For third, I want to be clear, so I am obliged to read my paper to give you a better information. I would like to talk to you about flute players automata throughout history. Why flute players automata? Worked by breath, the sound of the flute contains all that is visceral and cosmic on us. The flute is not very spectacular, but remains magical archetypes. The flute is used to guide every existence. Nomad on the Mesopotamian plains, Greek shepherds, as you can see in the screen in your left, Alexandrian thaumaturgists, Persian scholars, Etruscan sculptors, and Renaissance artists on the right. For these reasons, from the recurring theme, all the artists use this instrument to promote innocence and original purity everywhere at every age. Anyway, the mystic nature of the instrument means it is easily played. Nevertheless, automatic the trills and tongue work amazed the onlooker even more so when the animate figures start to move, adding to the bucolic poetry and musical enchantment. And so, when this invention bowed to the will of the miracle workers and played all by itself, there were many who sought to acquire the domination with such magic would give them. Among these guys, we consider two types of forerunners. The first one, as the creators, were the Alexandrian thaumaturges. Of course, Ctesibios, hero of Alexandria. You have a transcription of a book from Aleoti in the 16th century, who describe some design and device from Hero, and Philon of Byzantium. The second type of forerunners was those who pass on the knowledge. First example, the brother Banu Musa, living in Persia in the 9th century. On the screen, you have a picture of a clepsydra from Al-Jazari, the second one. It's a Mesopotamian of the 12th century who wrote the book of the knowledge of mechanical processes. You have the flute player on the fourth position on the left. And this page came from Topkapi Palace Museum Library. Another clepsydra from Al-Jazari, and you have the luck to have this in the Smithsonian Institute in Washington, show a clepsydra, a water clock, you know, with the 12 hours, 12 doors upstairs, and the trumpet and flute players below. Pages from this work, duplicated many times, were distributed throughout the Middle East during the Middle Ages. Now I'm going to jump through the age and talk about the great works of the master. In the 18th century, some philosophers, like the French René Descartes, used the metaphor of the automaton to test and disseminate his philosophical reasoning. In the same way, Offray de la Mettrie conceived and affirmed his aesthetic claims. In those days, many scientists believed in the possibility of an artificial man. For instance, you have on the screen the sketch of a prosthetist of the arm from Ambroise Paré, French surgeon in the 16th century. Another surgeon, Leucate, always from Paris, dazzled by the latest advances in science and medicine, was greatly interested in the project of the young Jacques de Vaucanson. This man regretted the dumbness of a Coystevox garden statue you have on the screen, as he wanted to voice this marble faun. He announced that he was able to create a flute player automaton, and he did it. Here is the mechanism as designed in Alfred Chapuis' books, The Automat, Les Automates, from 1949, on the right. I let you read the text on the next slide, as Alexandre Savérien, from his Dictionary of Mathematics and Physics in 1753, described this marvelous automaton. If the visual impact of the flute player is striking, not all mechanical makers are able to accomplish such an exploit. Many of them resort to imitation, for instance, a motionless figure and an automatic organ. For example, Ferdinand de Rothschild bought this lovely orphan organ clock at the end of the 19th century from his Waddesdon Manor in UK. All the components are hidden in the base, and here is a mechanism with the pipe work on the right, the chest below, and the cylinder at your left. Now, one of the masterpieces of the 18th century is in exhibition today in the Gasparini Ballroom in the Madrid Palacio Real. This work raised the name of its maker at the top of clockmaking craftsmanship. Of course, after the superb article you read in one of the last MBSI reviews, you already understand I am talking about Pierre Jacques Edrose and his famous Shepherd clock, 1753. El Reloj del Pastor, his Spanish name, put on scene among astronomical complications and artistic prodigies, a shepherd will play a recorder. Its role is to be a visual to entertainment. Figures are articulated, the flute is really played, and a lot of animation, the dog, lady, lovers, putty, on a seesaw, a lot of things. During the 18th century, a lot of ingenious creators made a soul piece in order to flatter the magnificence of princes or arouse the curiosity of crowds. These scientific travelers go through Europe to present masterpieces of their own making. Sometimes they sold them, but most of the time they just exhibited them as monsters or skilled animals. Moving now on the 19th century. The world changed profoundly at the end of the age of the Enlightenment. The revolution, French but Western also, I'm thinking about the emancipation of the British colony in the New World, confirmed the end of an economic and social system. This new era saw the arrival of industrious talents who wanted to satisfy the greatest number. The man I want to talk to you about now came typically from this way. He was born in 1801, first of all watchmaker, from a modest background. Pierre Stevenard had a passion for mechanics and automata. For that reason, he left his home village in the northern part of France and exhibited his product in downtown Paris in 1843. On the screen, you have a picture of this automaton who disappeared now, and on the right, you have the mechanism of a conjurer who used the same technique with pipes, silver pipes, very small. And as some had been suspicious of Vaucanson and Van Kempelen life-sized figures, claiming that they were worked by humans inside them, he chose to make small automata named pygmy automata. With a conjurer and a bird singing lesson, he put on show a flute player of 32 centimeters high. Here you can read one of the numerous related articles from l'Illustration in 1843. Report compared the automaton with a famous flutist, human flutist. Now, let's have a look at two main leaders in the toy industry of the 19th century. Fortunately, each one made flute player automata. But unfortunately, the figure inspired by an antique statue of the second century post-Dominum is always the same, except minor changes. We have found only one patent. And the model have no signature except one. So, each maker could be seen allocated the paternity of flute player's automata. The first maker is Alexandre Nicolas Théroud, born in 1807. As I develop the biography in the second part, I just give you some words about him. He established his first toy factory in 1831. He made his automata more naturalistic by enclosing the mechanism inside the body, removing the large pedestal which had spoiled the illusion. Between 1845 and 1873, 20 patents came to protect his works. The meeting with the organ builder Pierre-Ernest Kelsen led them to conceive together mechanical musical automata since 1858. The second maker is Jean Roulet. He was born in 1829. He founded a workshop as mechanic tool maker in this special area in the center of Paris. In front of the success of a first toy he made for a customer, he persisted in that way. Jean Roulet exhibited first at the Paris World Fair in 1878, as showed on the first page of the first known catalogue of his make, the flute player. To understand this clue I talked about before, you have to wait the second part of my presentation. Sorry, you need a second ticket. But to give you an idea, here is a trailer. But this trailer is not working. Please, Eve, can you help me? Oh, perhaps I have to make some. To have the figure in front of you than a video. She's right. May I continue? Continuing this form was Gustave Vichy, born in 1839. He made an Ethiopian flute player 82 centimeters high. A bourgeois plaything rather than a child toy. This figure has certain realism, raising the flute to his lips and moving his head as he was presenting the music before playing. The sound from a music box rather spoils the illusion. As Roulet's story will go on with his association with his son-in-law Ernest Decamp in 1889, Roulet Decamp made a shepherd with a recorder in the same manner. This is not the case of another Gustave Vichy automaton. This model is known as the bird catcher. Another model, which came out in 1890. This bird tamer, of which only few examples are known, holds the piccolo in his right hand, of which three fingers are articulated. and the bird listened and repeated the melodies on his left hand. In this case, the sound comes from a swanee whistle, and when the bird repeats the tune, the same type of mechanism play one octave higher. Now, it's very quick, but we go now to the second half of the 20th century. From the first babblings of computer science, scientists and creators use the new technology to demystify, explain or demonstrate scientifically what their great predecessor had determined empirically. So, we see the arrival of automata corresponding to the 20th century test, Android robots, which demonstrate the innovative capabilities of specialized laboratories or functional machines made to demonstrate a scientific thesis or an artistic performance. Among these makers is Martin Risch, a German people, which is flute playing machine made between 1979 and 1982. Yes, in fact, he has been making sound machines since the 70s. You have a transverse flute, 12 magnets to replace the 10 fingers, compressed air on the right. Then you have your musical instrument. The player is no more than a computer which operates the relays following information of the music sheet. The music sheet, in effect, a roll of transparent film scanned by an optical reader on the left. The notes are just drawn with a felt-tipped pen. On the next video, you can see this work. Sorry for the quality of the video, but I have just I have to copy from an old videotape from the 1880s, and color was seemed very psychedelic. Interact. the optical reader, the score, and the flute playing machine is just the just play the accompaniment, and the human flutist play the melodies. It's a good orchestrion. Melody is about 10 minutes. It's just an extract. On the other hand, the works of Franz Orlein, born in 1932, bring us back to the realm of poetic anecdote. Standing on a pedestal which contains the mechanism, a young Harlequin plays for Columbine, and a nightingale perched on a nearby balustrade replies. Maybe this can also be seen as a wish to escape from the aridity and inhumanity of technology we saw right now. It was with this challenge in mind that Franz Orlein made this Harlequin. It is remarkable how the fingers are synchronized with the music, as you can see in the magnificent collection at Jim and Sherry Kogoff yesterday, or the day before. They have the original. I make a video, but I think you have the luck to see the original. It's not necessary to put a bad video now. Sorry. You have to visit. 13 organ notes are allocated to the flute, and the relevant pipes are concealed in the figure chest. Similarly, 13 notes are concealed in the balustrade for the bird's response. Lastly, here is a robot of Waseda University. As the Bureau showed in Arizona in 2007, researchers from the Japanese University of Waseda presented a flute player who performed perfectly Rimsky-Korsakov Flight of the Bumblebee. This anthropomorphic android interacts with its entourage thanks to its camera eyes, which enable it to play a duet and to assist musician training. To present this present prototype as lungs in acrylic resin, elastic mouth and lips, and even a tongue which allows it to manage the airflow and its position on the mouthpiece. Remember, Jacques de Vaucanson was able to make the same with the 18th century technology. Please. you can see, the anatomy of this flute player is very close to human reality. And last but not least, what this robot likes, it's emotion that make great musician and great music. To conclude, some may be surprised by the recurring theme. I can see three reasons: artistic, scientific, and also religious. The history of art shows that artists feel the need to measure themselves against their predecessor, taking up the same subject over and over again, modifying its meanings, or, in the contrary, deforming it completely. This is an essential element of the creative process: to kill the father by undoing his work. And yet, who could deny the underlying link between the Paleolithic beginnings and Cubism? Who could refute the transgressive composition of Caravaggio and those of the Surrealists? Or who could disregard the slow maturation of the settings of subjects like La Pietà or our flute player? Reviewing an archetype, its interpretation, its evolution follows adaptation to the world for which he is created. Follows or precedes? Do artists have the power to change the world, or are they sentinels who foresee the change? Whatever the case, they accompany scientific progress, dreaming it, provoking it, and enhancing it. The transverse quality of knowledge means that every technology benefits from its neighbor. So, it is that on both sides of the world, across the Atlantic Ocean or across the street, researchers have disrupted the technological establishment, making the prototypes of essential features just like the ancient thaumaturges in order to better reach the public at large. And then the breath, a symbol of life in all religions, when it has been mastered, brings the inventor close to the supreme immanence. Agnostic or Protestant, infidel or believer, philosopher of the Enlightenment, or bourgeois artist, each try in his way to attain immortality through a great work. Thank you very much.
I wonder if it's too evident.
Completely original.